In our Southern Court tonight, we'll be looking at some of the people behind this campaign and their claim to be treated equally by the law and by society generally. In the film, you'll meet a teacher, a social worker, and others who are particularly concerned because of the nature of their work, what you'll think about their frank and open admission that they are homosexual. That admission, to oneself and to everybody else, is described by homosexuals as coming out, which is the title of our film. There are other expressions which may puzzle viewers, so I should explain before we start that gay means homosexual, and het is short for heterosexual, people who choose partners from among members of the opposite sex.
How did it happen to you then, personally, that you realised you fancied men instead of women?
Well, it sort of grew. For a start, you know, the little sex games that everybody plays when they're sort of 9, 10, I was taking a little more seriously than other people were. I went through all the stages people go through. I formed emotionally intense relationships at about the age of 15, which lasted for anything between, you know, half an hour and a matter of weeks. I formed a couple of relationships which were more or less, I suppose, the equivalent, if one has to have them, of the heterosexual engagement, which lasted for months, years. And now I'm living with somebody with whom I've been living for 5 years.
Alan Clark is General Secretary of CHE, the Campaign for Homosexual Equality. Current membership is 5,000, but the prospective membership is thought to be 1 in 10 of the people watching this programme. Alan Clark's mission is to persuade those latent homosexuals to express their true feelings in public, a process described in gay terms as coming out.
It's always difficult to feel fully relaxed walking on the road, hand in hand, or kissing. I always, although I do this, I like doing it because it's natural to me, I can't help feeling these twinges of reservations every time I kiss my boyfriend or hold his hand. You're very much aware that people are staring at you all the time.
Well, you must have had some feelings, though, of guilt or doubt or whatever, simply because of the way society feels about homosexuals, when you made up your own mind that you were gay.
Guilt, no. Doubt, no. I mean, those things... I mean, look at your sexuality. When were you guilty about being het? When did you doubt your heterosexuality? To me, by accident, largely, my homosexuality is normal, is something I've adjusted to. Very few homosexuals get that chance. I'm just, you know, very, very lucky. It's a fact that, you know, it's very difficult to get away from when I meet so regularly such large numbers of very hung-up gays.
What about your family?
Well, they're mostly het. I mean, as far as I know, they're all het. They rejected it at first. They refused. It didn't compute. It wasn't in their experience. They just sort of blacked it out, squeezed it out, and forgot about it. Now they accept it totally, and they don't give a damn.
Tell me your feelings when you first realised Alan was homosexual.
I was worried. My first reactions was, where had I gone wrong? What if I had done it?
It did appeal to me. I didn't go much on it at all. It was something that was distasteful, a little bit distasteful to me.
I've, in inverted commas, sort of settled down with an Oxford graduate and things, you know, made a good match. And that had I decided to live with an Oxford docker, if there are any doctors in Oxford, my parents might have had difficulty adjusting to it.
All I believe in is a straight sex between man and woman. But I have lately come to accept homosexuality with Alan, because of Alan.
Yeah, and the hurdle was talking about, you know, I knew that they knew, and they knew that I knew that they knew, but nobody actually talked about it. It was a sort of conspiracy not to. And I finally thought about 4 years ago, you know, this just isn't good enough. And I'd seen my mother throw her hands up in the air and say, I don't want to talk about it, when the subject had approached several times. I thought, well, you know, she's got to. Not because it's my problem, but because it's hers. You know, she can't talk about an aspect of her son's life, and that's got to be changed. So I told her all about it. At first she appeared a little bit nervous, you know, but she accepted it. And then she, my father, my sister and brother-in-law came up to visit quite soon afterwards, the house where my boyfriend and I were living. And I hadn't talked to it with my father at all. And while he was parking the car, I showed my sister and mother around the house, including the bedroom, with the double bed and the pin-ups on the walls. And then we went into the sitting room. And then my father arrived and said, well, you can show me around the house. And I said, well, I've done it once. It's boring. Go and have a look. And my sister, my mother, and I just sat there giggling furiously, waiting to see what his reaction would be, because we just didn't know. And he sort of sauntered back in 10 minutes later and sort of walked over to the window and looked out and rolled himself a cigarette and didn't say a word.
I thought it was terrific, quite honestly. I thought, what a lovely life. They've no worries. They've no responsibilities. They love their life.
How did you feel about it when you had to confront the realities of the situation of him actually making love with another man?
I don't think I liked it very much. But then, who am I to judge? It's not my place to judge him.
Well, let's put it this way. I accepted it simply because, basically, I love my children. I love Alan just as much as I do my daughter and my youngest son. Nobody can ever change that love. It's a very deep, affectionate love for all of them.
Che is fighting to alter attitudes to homosexuality, attitudes which persuade many people, including gays, that they are sick, which drive at least 40 a year to suicide. It's a campaign of education and of political lobbying to change the law so homosexuals can express their love openly. More controversially, it hopes to change the age of consent from 21 to 16. As part of this campaign, gays in Brighton have formed a new group to persuade homosexuals to come out. It's called Icebreakers, and one of its founders is Brian Hart.
Like my friends at school, I had girlfriends when I was 16 and 17, but it just seemed totally alien to me somehow to go around with girls. And I was always sort of left out alone in dance halls and discotheques. I used to go out with my mates, and they all had girlfriends. And I used to go home early, and my mum would say, you know, why have you come home? And I used to say, well, it doesn't interest me dancing. And I used to end up going up to my room and listen to music and that sort of thing, because I just naturally felt very much out of it. Well, when I was about 20, I realised that I couldn't go on shutting myself away. I'd told myself that I wasn't homosexual and that I couldn't possibly be one of those queers that you read about in Sunday papers. I just couldn't bottle it up anymore. I had to do something about it, so I went and saw my doctor, because I thought at that time that homosexuality was a curable disease. You know, these sort of ideas fed into you at childhood. But I remember getting a book from the library called Self-Hypnosis, and I had to spend a couple of hours trying to hypnotise myself into the fact that I wasn't homosexual. It's quite disgusting, really. I mean, the things that some gay people do to themselves because they believe that they're perverted and wrong. I'm not angry against hets because I realise that they are just as oppressed as we are. What does annoy me is the way that society expects everyone to conform to a certain norm. And in any society, there is no one norm. Everyone is in a minority of some sort or other. My heterosexual friends, my workmates, and my family all know I'm gay. And to them, there's no hassles about that whatsoever. They just accept it now, and it's marvellous.
The amount of courage you need to do it is far greater than the opposition you will encounter once you have. Because everything in you screams against it. Everything says, don't do it. And that decision, the decision to come out, is much harder than anything that happens thereafter. Much, much harder.
For most people who are watching, when you talk about sexuality, the automatic thought is the act of sex itself. Mm-hmm. And surely the sexual equipment everybody has favours the man and woman relationship.
No, I think that the sexual equipment we have favours procreation in the sense that heterosexuality is much better for having babies than homosexuality. Nobody's debating that. Whether it's better for sexual fulfilment is, of course, in a highly civilised society, with people who are capable of emotional love and making relationships, then I don't think you can use this simplistic argument that homosexuality is less natural because somehow it doesn't seem to fit together. I like to see a society where people were free to make relationships with whom they chose. And I'm talking about, you know, free adult people who have the right under law to marry and to fight for their country and to vote, and who at the moment can't even choose who they want to make a relationship with. It can't be right. It really can't.
You're gay yourself. Tell me about some of the hassles you had in coming out.
Well, I became aware that I was attracted to women, or at that time girls, when I was about 13. But I never really felt the pangs of guilt that a lot of the people I see professionally have felt, and a lot of the people I've been friends with in the gay movement have felt. I don't know why that is. Perhaps I was just lucky.
I think in the back of every lesbian's mind, there is the belief that in some way you are perverted. I mean, I would walk through a park holding hands with a girlfriend of mine and be shouted at by teenage kids. No. Now, that of course, that's going to make you doubt where you're at.
I mean, I told my parents because, well, I had no way out at the time. And they were very upset. And I have known, my best friend was gay, and she told her parents, and her mother had a heart attack. I mean, she really did take it badly. And obviously, for my friend, this was a tremendous, you know, really traumatic thing. To see her parents so upset. She was very fond of her parents. Mm.
I know that my mother is sorely disappointed, and nothing I can do, if I start a school and it's very successful, nothing I can ever do will make up for the fact that I'm not going to produce a grandchild for her. Mm. And my sister-in-law said, well, of course, you're a consenting adult. It's up to you what you do. But I wouldn't leave you alone with the baby. And she was at this time pregnant. The sex of the baby was undetermined. People seemed to ask me what sex was the baby, as if it had some relevance. But I mean, I found that incredibly insulting. What does she think I'm going to do to that child?
Brighton
27878. Phone number of the gay switchboard, otherwise known as the Lavender Line, contact point in the south of England for homosexuals with problems. It's run from the Open Cafe in Brighton and manned four nights a week by homosexuals who have come out and who are happy to give advice and information to those who have yet to commit themselves. Sometimes it's as simple as passing on the addresses of gay clubs and pubs. Sometimes it results in more serious contact with people who are frightened to admit their homosexuality to parents, friends, wives, even to themselves. For two members of Gay Switchboard, David and Jack, this program is in itself a further step in coming out. As two homosexuals living together, they are still wary of the effect this might have on friends and colleagues.
I realized many years ago that I was gay, and in fact, I reflect the 1950s, as I'm 41 years of age, and I was very concerned at the time that my parents shouldn't find out. It worried me very considerably. I had several gay friends, most of them older than myself, and I used to get very anxious when they used to telephone me because I was still living at home. But it wasn't until many years later, in fact, that I did confront my parents the fact that I was gay.
Yes, it's really, you know, a very difficult situation at first, just to accept it in yourself. Let alone to tell other people, and something that's impossible to do without mingling with gay people that have already gone through the same thing and come out the other side, and being honest with themselves.
What's the sort of gut reaction that you have to attitudes about queers and puffs and pansies?
It angers me very considerably.
The trouble is that one can, if you want to, you can pretend it doesn't apply to you, because we don't look particularly gay. People with me tend to think that just because I've got a beard...
Well, effeminate, but
talking about men, people think that men who are homosexual are necessarily automatically effeminate, you know, the way they hold their hands.
Yes.
I think, no, some homosexual men are, but the majority are not by any means. And it's very easy to assume the role of a heterosexual when a homosexual person is being degraded or being made fun of. It's very easy to slip into the other disguise.
I think this is one of the big problems with gays, is the fact that the public idea, the public image of the typical gay is a sort of limp-wrist, swinging handbag type person. And, of course, a surprise in some instances. But there are plenty of gays that look, you know, just like anybody else.
The trouble is just facing up and being honest with other people about the fact that you're gay when you're often in a position where it's more comfortable, it's an easy way out to pretend that you're not. And that's really something that it's very difficult to get gay people to do. And I failingly admire myself quite often, I feel. Just because it's easier, you get on better with people if you don't cause a scene sometimes, and you should really.
When did you actually start living together? Well, how did you meet? Presumably when you met it, illegal, technically.
Yes, because I met David over 3 years ago, when David, of course, was under 21, and according to the 1967 Act, it was illegal.
Which is ridiculous, really.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, when young boys and girls are married at 16 and having kids, it makes the whole situation absurd to think that I couldn't make up my own mind as to who I wanted to go to bed with, or you know, the trouble is that when people talk about sexuality, they only think of the sexual thing, and in fact there's a lot more. Living with people is a whole lifestyle, really, in a way. That's a very small part of it. In actual fact, when we first met, we never had any sexual relations at all. It started off the other way around, as a conventional kind of friendship, the way that a boy might date a girl. and grew up from there. That's just peculiar in their case.
We started living together, it's now about, 18 months ago?
Yeah.
We first started living together.
Yeah. And I can foresee us living together for some, you can see no end, really.
I have a particular problem myself. Well, it's not a problem for me, it's a problem for everyone else, in the fact that I'm under 21, and under the law this means that I cannot have any form of homosexual relationship. So, legally I can come out as much as I like, but I can't do anything about it.
A meeting of the Brighton Icebreakers group to encourage homosexuals to come out. For those in the social services or in education, the problem is acute.
It heartens me now when I see young people coming out much more positively in a much shorter time than it's taken me to come fully out. It's taken me, I suppose, about 10 years. The sense of freedom that I feel now is really terrific within myself. I think this has occurred mainly in the last 7 months, since I totally came out in my job as a social worker, a local social worker in Brighton. And when I applied for the job in April, I made it clear that I was gay on the application form, and it was just like a cloud had lifted from me.
As somebody who is in something of thought to be a tricky situation sometimes, being both gay and a probation officer, I think most people know that I've always been open about the fact that I'm gay. I haven't hidden it from people, and I've never had any particular difficulties from the probation service because of that. Sometimes situations have arisen which I felt unhappy that I'm not being accorded the same respect as somebody who isn't gay would be accorded in a particular situation. There was a recent example came up at work where a case was allocated at a meeting, and it was a case where it was a 23-year-old homosexual who had a lot of problems and who it seemed had some rejection from the probation service in the past. And I said that I felt that I had a lot to offer in that particular case and would like to deal with it. But I felt that the case was in fact deliberately kept away from me for certain reasons. Now, I was angry and upset about that, and obviously feeling that way, I couldn't let the situation go by. And at the next meeting, I brought the subject up again, and we had a discussion about it, and even those probation officers who before we hadn't really discussed being gay with me were forced to take sides. And in fact, everybody agreed that my being gay should not affect what cases were allocated to me, that I was as trained and as experienced as anybody else in the office to deal with any case on whatever basis. There was some discussion by a couple of the officers about my vulnerability. And by this, they meant that in certain situations, we're dealing with clients who can be very upset and want to get their own back on people and will hit out at the probation officer's weakest point. And if I was openly gay, they would assume that me being gay was my weakest point and may make some unfounded accusations. But because I was known to be gay by everybody, there would be a suspicion in some people's mind that this sort of accusation may not be unfounded. But we discussed that one fully, and again, you know, they decided that that was, that, you know, perhaps some lingering of their own fears and prejudices in that.
There was a small incident today when I was out with Tony today in the street, and we held hands, and an adolescent boy and an adolescent girl came up to us and asked us the time. Well, we gave them the time, and then they continued following us down the street. And so eventually I turned around to them and I said, well, look, you know, do you want to know anything? So they said, you know, are you poofs? So I said, no, we're gay. So the boy said, well, I'm gay too. So I said, well, you know, what do you mean by this? And of course he wasn't too sure. And he kept on, they kept on following us down the street and sort of harassing us more or less. And we didn't stop holding hands. And of course other people were looking. I mean, coming out is about that too. It's about showing affection in public. And this is extremely hard. Because as soon as you start doing that, you do come up against this. Now you have to tackle this all the time. It's very wearing.
I was 21 when I sort of, really quite frankly, woke up one morning, found out I'd been with a bloke. And absolute horror of horrors. All sorts of thoughts went through my head. God, am I sick? This, that and the other. Is there a tablet that I can get rid of this terrible affliction that hit me?
But you had heterosexual relations?
Yes, indeed. I was engaged to be married. And so I was very worried. And I went along to see my doctor. You know, what can I do? Is there psychiatric help? And my doctor did the biggest favour for me that he's ever done. He turned around to me and said, go away. Stop being so damn silly. Go away and enjoy your life. If any attitudes in society are going to be changed, they're going to be changed by gay people themselves, turning around saying, I'm gay and so bloody what. You accept me for what I am and I'm enjoying life and I'm a human being. If everyone, every gay person did that, then so there would be no problem in society from sort of the social point of view. Obviously there'd still be the legal problems, and that's up to pressure groups like CHE, GLF and the rest of them to try and persuade MPs, etc., to change the law.
Are you conscious that the scenes that happen nightly in this club, of men dancing cheek to cheek, holding hands, flirting with each other, would be offensive to heterosexual society?
John, I think that's a terribly narrow-minded question, and I'm not attacking you personally, but attack people that would think that it is offensive. What Mrs. Jones is doing next door, in bed with her husband, might upset Mrs. Williams next door. I'll answer it like that. Whatever someone does between themselves, if it's hurting nobody else, it shouldn't offend anybody. If somebody wants to do something, they should be allowed to do it, as long as it's not hurting in any way somebody else. It can offend. All right, if someone wants to be narrow-minded enough to be offended, that's entirely up to them.
To think that I'd been trying to crush this thing inside me, you know, my emotions, to try and get rid of them, I think it's just criminal. You know, I want to do my damnedest to make sure that society becomes a much better place where homosexual people can grow up, realise that their homosexuality is valid and beautiful and not something disgusting and to be ashamed of.
Can come true, it can happen to you if you're young at heart.